Okay guys, as you can see, now my clothes rack is ready. I'm gonna put that inside my tipi, about 2 feet from the stove. It's gonna be very easy to dry my clothes now. This was very needed, so I'm happy I got this done today. I got space for my hat, for my pants, for my, well, anything, even for my gloves. Got some shelves here. Well, not shelves, but bars that you can put extra clothing. If you want to dry socks or whatever, liners. And it keeps the air, it can go in, the hot air can go in through here and come out, dry my hood also instead of being flat or hung. So I think it's very good. Got space for my hats also, right at the top. Can even put 2 hats, one in each little thing. And one of the main reasons I had to do that is because I was drying my clothes very near to the stove, and this is what can happen. Mega damage. And out here, you don't want that to happen, because if you lose your clothes, you're kind of in trouble. So yeah, about time. The ground here is frozen, so I'm using a digging stick that I made with birch and my hatchet to pierce the soil, so it makes my job easier. Not so bad. So I've dug my holes with my digging stick. Now, moment of truth. I think that's good enough. I can hang my clothes in a safe distance from the fire. Hey, Betches, we should go and look for wood now. You ready to go? It's solid. Not going anywhere. Here we go, buddy. Let's go. Let's go get some wood. Ready to go? Awesome. Me too. Nice! Wow! Wow, snow bath! Lucky boy, look at your sweat all wet now. What are you gonna do after, huh? You know what we're gonna do? We're gonna use our dry rack to dry your sweater. Because now it's not a problem, huh? You can get it all wet and then we get it dry in 5 minutes. You happy now? You funny doggy. Let's go. Deer tracks. Coming from the tippy.
Just want to show you guys how well my drying rack works. Maybe you can see, look at the steam. Fire on, obviously. But look at that. Mr. Scarecrow, the dry rack. As promised, I said I was going to show you what I have here. So let's have a look. Okay, here I have a bag full with about 20 portions of dry pasta. Okay, so here a couple of noodles. Again, more like snacks. I have a lot of these cans, they're black beans. Here I have some mashed potato with some milk, all dried. I have about, I don't know, 10 portions of this stuff. Some olive oil, here's some mustard, it's probably frozen. Ketchup, frozen. These are all spices. Down there I have a couple of packs of tuna, more beans over there. And the main food is also here in these plastic boxes. There's two boxes. And here I have rice, flour, more spices, a bit of stock. You know, basically my grains are here. Some packs with tomato sauce also. More beans. Like I said, mostly grains, you know. So there, guys. And the rest is all outside, all the meats and things like that. And cheeses and butters and frozen vegetables.
Today I'm going to try the DDhammocks super light hammock to sit down and hang my gear. As you can see, having a hammock strung here near me, it's great to put my gear as I unpack my bag. Something like that, nothing touches the snow, nothing gets wet. It's perfect. Plus, you get to relax after. Here's my brushes, canvas, paper towels, trash bag. That's it. Well, we're not in a lot of problems, but it's always a learning process. Not happy with it. I have to have a hot drink. Grams of pure joy.
So how warm does it get here when it's minus outside, minus temperatures? The stove is not even full of wood. It's got two logs in it, and we have about, well, right now it's nearly 25 degrees Celsius. I don't know if you can see that. Close to 80 Fahrenheit. Not bad. What I have going on over there is once the stove is off, I don't go to sleep with a stove on. It's dangerous. Can get carbon monoxide poisoning. So what I'm doing now is just warming up my water. I'm not really boiling it. It's disinfected. And this is a vacuum bottle, and the water will stay warm for 12 hours or so. Like that. I got some nice warm water waiting for me in the morning. Just wanted to show you how I keep my paintings in a tipi, and it's with this product called Raymar Wet Painting Carrier. Basically, it's just a plastic box with a couple of trays. It fits six paintings, 20 by 20 centimeters, and I usually do about a painting a day, or at least that's what I'm aiming for while I'm in the tipi. I don't show you all the paintings I make. Usually out of six paintings that I do per week, maybe three will be good. You know, that's the nature of plein air. You know, it's the way it is. Anyway, I'm gonna share with you some of the work I have for the past week, apart from one painting here, it's a little older than that. What I do is on Saturday, I usually take this with me and I go home and I bring fresh panels, blanks, so I can paint for the following week. Let's start with the first one where the camera died. It's a painting of my tipi. Excuse the light here. It's a very cold light, so it's not a natural light at all. And I can show you this on daylight. It's probably better, but right now this is what I got. So that's one of the paintings I made. This is a spruce. I had a lot of fun doing this one. This one was painted straight on wood, just experimenting, you know. The other one that you just saw was linen on board. This next painting, it's my camp when the sun was setting. It's like basically at dusk, and I had the fire going, and unfortunately the light here does not make it justice. And this is also painted on plain plywood, and just keep it natural, right? For me, it's like the best painting I've made here on the Tipi Diary so far. And also, some of these paintings are going to become big paintings. You know, I'm going to make a couple of 100 versus 100 centimeters paintings for the exhibition. The exhibition will be in Stockholm and also around here where I live. And yeah, really happy with this one. The reason why I'm not showing all the work that I've been doing here, it's because my plan is at the end of the Tentipi Diaries, I'm going to make an exhibition, and then I want to release, you know, if people see all the work, I mean, what's the point of coming to see the exhibition, right? So I'm trying to share a little bit, but at the same time, I'm holding back quite a lot of the paintings I'm making. I've also been painting a bunch of sunsets, and again, very tricky to film because it's getting dark and the battery dies because it's freaking snow everywhere and it's cold. But this is one of the best sunsets that I also made here. And again, the warm colors like the orange and the yellows are not coming out because of the light here in the tipi. I'm trying to see if I get this right. Maybe like this, you can get the feeling of the sunset. And yeah, I'm not going to show any more today, but I'll try and show a couple here and there. But I would really want to keep some of them private until the exhibition time. There. Safe and sound. Alright guys, I'm going to try and do a Q&A. I hope the battery doesn't die. It's -5 outside. Let's get on with it. Just one thing. If I don't answer your question, it's because it's either been answered already, or the answer for the question is in one of the episodes. Just for the sake of keeping this short, I'm not going to repeat the same questions. But again, thanks for asking, but you know, if I don't answer, just go through the episodes or go through the comments on past episodes and you'll probably find your answer there. Question by Mary KB. When you melt snow for drinking water, do you have to bring it to a boil to kill bacteria, or is it safe to drink after just melting? It's safe to drink straight away, you know. It comes from up there, as long as it's not yellow. You don't have to put it into a boil, or, you know, it's safe to drink. At least I've never had a problem with it. Thanks for the question, Mary. Next question by Walter Kolb. Hi, Rick. Outstanding video once again. Thanks for the tip with the char cloth. Are you really able to paint under these conditions, like -15 Celsius? And how do you keep your business running when you are so long away from home? Keep safe and warm greetings from Germany. Yeah, I'm totally able to paint. Sometimes I have trouble with the medium. It can get a little drippy. So I had to, you know, get the right settings, you know, the right amount of thinner and the right amount of oil. because in the beginning I was using too much thinner and it would drip, and it was dripping. But no problem. The problem that I'm having with the painting, and the reason why I'm not showing all the paintings that I'm doing, it's a couple of reasons. One of the reasons is because I'm planning to do an exhibition at the end of the Tipi Diaries series, so I don't want to show all the work right now. I can show some. But the main reason, you know, I want to film and I want to show you guys, you know, me painting some of the paintings right now. The main reason why, you know, there's not a lot, it's because of the temperature. My camera just can't handle it. You know, my painting, sometimes it takes me an hour, sometimes it takes 4 hours in one go, in one session, and the battery just dies. It just can't handle it. How do I keep my business running when I'm so long away from home? Well, most of it, you know, takes care of itself. You know, like I have prints for sale on Fine Art America, and that's all automated. My website is also automated if you buy a painting from there. And then my wife helps me a lot. She's like an angel. And, you know, if there's anything that needs to be posted or answered, she'll give me a hand. Most of my business emails and things like that, I do it with an iPad around this time, 6 p.m. Thank you for your question, Walter. I hope that answered. Next question by Kigawa Man. Hello, Kigawa Man. Hi, Nagualero. Great episode. I have a couple of questions. A, have you ever tried watercolor painting? Yes. B, do you have a YouTube link of your Bush Kitchen Time series? I was trying to look for it, but I can't find it. The video's already up. It's been up for 2 weeks. Thank you for your question, Kigawa Man. Next question by Matthew McDonald. He wrote a pretty big comment, so I'm not going to read all of it, Matthew, but thank you so much. I'm just going to focus on your question here. I noticed you insulated around your tippy posts. What did you use?
Fire blanket. Those that you can buy on gas stations, you know, just to, you have a fire and you throw the blanket on top. So I just wrapped that around a couple of times on the pole, and so far, no fires. Thank you for your question, Matthew, for this very nice long comment. I appreciate it. Sue Dahabsu. Hello, maestro. It was good to see you on the Tipi Diary. For a while I was wondering what's happening, but I see you well and continue having fun in the forest. Yes, I'm having fun. Lots of fun. I have enough paintings to submit. It's been 1 year in February since I started to paint, thanks to you, because you have inspired me. I have enough paintings to submit to a local art gallery. One of the questions from the application was asked about painting experience. I don't know what to say about training. What are your suggestions? Well, Sue, just stick to the truth, you know. If you don't have training, if you're self-taught, there is no shame on that. You know, I think the most important is to have confidence on your own work and in yourself. And that should be enough, you know. And your CV, you build with time. But you have to start somewhere, right? Glad to hear that the Tipi Diaries have inspired you to paint. That's awesome. Thank you for your question, Sue. I'll put some more wood on this. Fire! 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 I thought it'd be a lot cozier to answer your questions in front of a fire, since I always do it inside the tipi, you know, a little different. And like that, you guys get to be out here with me. All right, let's go. YouTube101X asks, love this episode. You mentioned living in South Africa. Is that where you're from? Trying to place your accent. No, I mentioned that I lived in South America, not South Africa. And have you ever traveled to camped in the US? So many beautiful places to camp that are under the protection of the National Park Service, Maine, West Virginia, etc. No, I haven't, but I look forward to one of these days. Definitely on my to-do list. Thank you for your question, YouTube101X. Next question by Wonder Tribe. Hi Rick, would you tell us which gear you have is sponsored? Love the show, Chris. I'll ask. Some companies don't want, you know, people to know that they're sponsoring people so they don't get overloaded with requests. Some don't care, some are happy about it. I'll ask. Whoops. Fire in the hole. But you know, as I make, you know, mentions of products and whatever, I really don't want to sit here and go like, wow, this was sponsored or this was not, or I bought this or I didn't. I think I should focus more on saying if the product is good or it's not, if it works here in the situation or it doesn't. So I guess I'm going to focus on that. But anyway, I'll ask, and if they say yes, sure. Thank you for your question, Chris. Thomas Lang, great. How is that Eka 88 Swede working out as a kitchen knife? Amazing. Awesome. I mean, I bought that knife in 2007 when I arrived in Stockholm. And I still have it, and I've been using it every single day. So, can't say enough good things about it. Thank you for your question, Thomas. I think my sausage is getting done. Buckeye Bushcraft L asks or comments, oh, my wife wants to buy that painting of your tipi. I told her that might be impossible. We already spoke over email. Just wanted to share with everybody that if you see a painting that I'm doing here and if you want to buy it, just send us an email to nagualero@gmail.com and we'll take care of it for you. Thanks for your comment, Buckeye. Or I mean Stefan. Sukilu 1964 asks, do you find these long periods of being isolated are having an effect on your mind?
Cuckoo, cuckoo.
I would imagine being away from normal daily hustle and bustle, interaction with people and etc. really stills your mind and your thinking. Are you finding this to be the case? Love the series, thanks.
Well, Sukilu.
Well, I'm not really isolated for long periods because I'm going home to edit the video every weekend. And I see my wife, you know, the longest I haven't seen her was 2 weeks on the row. I don't feel alone at all. Today, the sky is full of stars. You have the trees, you have the animals, you have the sounds. There's so much around you here. And if you're at peace with it, everything becomes part of your company. You know, you're surrounded by friends. Don't worry, I'm not mad or anything. But that's how I feel, you know? This is not an oppressive solitude. I think solitude is horrible if it's not chosen. You know, if you find yourself without anybody to talk to and you didn't choose that and you're in a situation like that, it's horrible. This is a chosen thing and it's different for me. You know, I really enjoy it. And like I said, my wife comes over a lot, you know, just to say hi. Thank you for your question, Sukilu. I hope that answered. Next question by September Phoenix. That's Woody. Hey, Woody. Good to hear from you, brother. Have you ever made tea with pine needles? Yeah, plenty of times. I drink that stuff like nearly every day. It keeps away the flu. I don't know why I haven't filmed that yet, but I will, brother. Thank you for your question. Free Ride Liberal asks, what kind of deer, white tail or black tail, are there? Nice music at the end. Have you ever played an instrument, and if so, what kind? What kind of deer? Well, the ones I see, they have definitely white butts. But, you know, I'll post on the next video a whole list of all the animals we have here in Sweden. And so it's there, and I'll leave that in one of the episodes, like under the comments or under the description. Have I ever played an instrument? Yeah, I love playing music. I play my acoustic guitar. What else? I tried to scratch the mandolin. I wouldn't say I know how to play it, but I definitely know how to play it my way, whatever that means. I also play the didgeridoo and percussion, like, you know, anything that you can drum. Oops. Anyway, yeah, I love playing music, and as soon as the weather gets better and more stable, I'll probably bring something here to play. Thank you for your question, Free Ride Liberal. Next question by Seth. I'm sorry, I'm murdering your name. S-E-T-H-E-H. Anyway, in which medium did you paint it? Oils, I assume. Acrylic would probably freeze. Yeah, I painted that with oils. If you mean the last painting that I did here on the video, episode 9, right? Thank you for your question. Wonder Tribe asks, Rick, this one was too short. I think you mean episode 9. Well, here's another question. I'm falling in love with the tipi life, and the tentipi seems to be an ideal companion for cozy nights outdoors. There are different sizes of tentipi tents. You have the number 7, if I remember correctly, which should be fine for one person, an oven, petros, and a bunch of things. But if you had to choose again, would you pick a larger size next time? Chris. No, not to do the Tipi Diaries series. Why? Because I don't need that much space. I thought the smaller size is better because it'll take less wood to heat it up. You know, the closer the space, I mean, sorry, the smaller the space, the easier it is to heat it up. I thought about the Tipi 9. It would be more spacious, it'd be more, you know, less cramped up. I would be able to walk more freely in there. But that's the point. But I didn't think that was important for me because I don't spend my whole day inside the tipi. That's not the point. I go there to sleep and to chill out for an hour or two. The rest, I'm out painting or I build a shelter now that I can be outside. And if I do have to be in there, it's okay, you know. Thank you for your question, Wonder Tribe. I mean, Chris. Sana Kauhanen Art. Hi Rick, I was wondering what canvas you use. I have seen that you have pre-stretched ones at your studio and that you have unstretched canvas for plein air. I'm going to buy unstretched and I would love to hear your opinion on your favorites before committing. Thank you for creating such wonderful videos for us viewers. I love Sweden nature, even more experiencing our nature through you who goes all in. Best regards, Sana in Sweden. Hey Sana. My opinion. I like both. I like canvas and I like unstretched. Just like the actual piece of canvas. And I usually glue that on a board. I use some tape and I tape it around. The thing is, boards are heavy. Canvases, not so heavy. I have a little cardboard tube like this. And inside I have about 20 little squares of canvas already pre-cut, all rolled up, and I put that inside. And then I have one piece of like a board where I tape it each time I need a new painting. Here on the tipi I'm using a hard board most of the time, like panels, painting panels, because I have a box where I can put up to 8 paintings. And they're wet, so they have to be stored like that, and then at the end of the week I take them home with me. I don't know, I would say try, you know, it's completely different feeling. I actually prefer to paint on a loose canvas. What I mean by that is like without any boards or solid material in the back, because I like the feeling of the canvas moving a little bit, you know, that, I don't know, it's just me. Thank you for your question, Sana. I hope that helped. I can't say your name. The basin is tallish. Sorry, totally murdered it. Your question. Hey Rick, I just watched all the episodes in the last week or so because I didn't have time before. While watching, I came up with a lot of questions. Maybe you could answer them. And it's awesome that you painted outside at minus 20. Too bad that the camera doesn't assist you as well, but I appreciate how you keep going on. And taking the time to set the camera in different locations and the time you put in all the editing. Thank you. So stay safe out there, and here are the questions. 1. Are you afraid that someone robs your stuff out of your tipi? Example, when you go to collect wood or go home for editing. Well, it's a thought, But not many people know the location where I'm at on purpose because of that. And hunters don't really wander in this particular spot. That's one of the reasons why I chose it also. There's no hunting towers here. But let's hope it doesn't happen, right? Okay, number two. You put your tipi on the ground without any layer in between. I guess now it's just hard and frozen. But in the days when you had heavy rain, why doesn't the ground get wet and soaked under the tipi? Because I chose the right location. The soil here, one of the main reasons that I put my tipi here, it's that it's pretty mossy. And what I mean by that, it's not boggy, but it's lofty enough that whenever like the snow falls, you can see if it doesn't snow more, in one day the ground just sucks it out. Same thing with water. As soon as it rains, it goes right into the ground. If the soil was more like clay, it would be a mess. So it would be impossible. You know, you'd have puddles and mud everywhere. But this soil, the spot that I'm in, it drains perfectly, and also there's a big inclination down that side, so all the water just goes straight out, you know. So there's no, well, it's one of the things that I really thought, you know. I didn't just pick this place out of like, oh, it looks pretty. I really went through a whole checklist that I made just to be sure that I would not have problems, including the trees. But sometimes, you know, problems happen anyway, like you saw in that episode where the tree fell. Okay, three. In some videos, your dog wasn't there. Does your wife take him home sometimes? You bring him home, and I was wondering what you give him to eat, other than bits of food he gets from your cooked food. Do you store any dog food? Yeah, I have 2 weeks worth of dog food at all times here, up in the tree. I kind of give that to birds also. What else? What was your question? Does my wife take him home sometimes? My wife shows up a lot with her horse. When she goes horse riding, you know, she comes over. Sometimes she brings Petrus and he decides to stay with me. Sometimes he's already with me and she takes him home. And I think I already answered this before. But a lot of times you don't see him in the videos when I'm filming, because most of the time he's here with me, as long as it's not like minus 20 or something, you know. He's sleeping in my bed inside the teepee, you know, just snoring it away. Okay. Four. With the painting outdoors, how do you clean your brushes and where do you dispose the polluted solvent? Or do you just wipe them clean? I most wipe my brushes with paper towels and then I burn the paper towels. But I also use water. I use water soluble oils because, you know, it's non-toxic. I hate turpentine. I hate the smell. I know that there are odorless turpentines and white spirits. I just don't like any of that stuff. So water soluble oils for me they work just fine, you know. Apparently they don't freeze because there is no water on the actual tube, you know. The tube is pigment and oil. You have to mix water on it. When I clean my brushes, I usually just use water and soap, and then I have a plastic bottle which is about 2.5 liters where I always dump the dirty water. Then I close it and it's in my tipi. I can show you if you want. Then I just put it in my backpack, and in the weekend when I go home to edit, I take it with me and dump it. I hope that answered all your questions. Thank you so much. I also, again, would like to say thank you so much for all the positive feedback that I've been getting for this series. It's been really cool. And thank you so much for all your comments. And I'm sorry I'm not reading all of them out loud, because, you know, I want to keep the video short as possible. But again, I always read them and I always really appreciate your effort when you write it. And thank you so much.